So today's session, so far we have discussed about the so where is recording option? Please wait. Hello? இல்ல இல்ல ப்ரோ, நம்ம படிக்க ஆரம்பிச்சாச்சு, ஒன்றும் பிரச்சனை இல்லை அப்படின்ட்டு. நோ இஷ்யூ, கண்டிப்பாக அந்த மாதிரி பண்ணிடலாம். ஓகே ஓகே, கிளாஸ் முடிச்சுட்டு நான் இது ஓகே. ஸோ ஃபார் வாட் வி ஹாவ் டிஸ்கஸ்ட் வித் ரெஸ்பெக்ட் டு அவர் கரிக்குலம் இஸ் ஸோ வி ஹாவ் டிஸ்கஸ்ட் அபவுட் த சர்வீசஸ் ஆஃப் ஈசி2 அமேசான் எலாஸ்டிக் கம்ப்ளீட் கிளவுட். வி ஹாவ் கம்ப்ளீட்டட் அவர் டிஸ்கஷன் ஆஃப் ஈசி2. So here we are dealt with taking Linux instance and how to configure a database here, how to configure the languages here, okay, how to configure a web server here, and we also discussed about some things using Windows, how to configure a Windows server. So in terms of security perspective, we have discussed a lot of things associated with the security rules. By adding, removing rules, how to allow and deny access. And in terms of storage has been concerned, we have discussed about the concept of S3, Amazon Simple Storage Services. We have discussed about the EBS, Elastic Block Store, how to create a volume, how to attach the volume, etc., etc. We have discussed about this Glacier, Amazon Glacier. These are all the things associated with storage. And in terms of the load balancer, we have discussed about this Elastic Load Balancer. Okay, we will be having further discussions with respect to Elastic Load Balancer and auto scaling. Okay, at the end. And we have discussed about some basics of auto scaling. And we have discussed about in terms of monitoring, we have discussed about CloudWatch, how to configure alarm, how to monitor the resources, etc., etc. So apart from that, we also discussed in terms of mail in our SLS class. Simple email service, simple queuing services. Okay, these are all the things that we have discussed. Amazon CloudWatch, auto scaling, Elastic Load Balancer, S3, EBS, Glacier, EC2, mail service, queuing services. Then let me wait. Let me check up with our curriculum. Okay, so overview of yes, we also discussed about the Amazon. We have completed the discussion of this curriculum. Elastic Compute Cloud fully, and then in terms of the Amazon second management console, we have discussed about getting start with regions, configuring credentials with respect to IAM. Okay, so we have discussed with respect to IAM, how to create the group, how to give permissions, and so on, so on. And we discussed about how to configure Amazon command line interfaces, CLI mode of interfaces. Then we have configured about auto scaling. Okay, how to do auto scaling. We had to discuss about how to club auto scaling with Elastic Load Balancing. How to do scale up and scale down activity. And then we have also discussed about IAM. And in terms of storage, we discussed about S3, Glacier, EBS. So whether we have completed our cloud front. So these are, let me make a note of the thing that we left out. I think so. We have yet to discuss this Amazon CloudFront. Amazon CloudFront. You please people help me in this regard. Okay. So Amazon Root S3 DNS service. We have discussed about this VPC, and we need to discuss about the Amazon Cloud Formation, the template-based creation, how to make use of Amazon Cloud Formation, We discussed about RDS, NoSQL databases, Amazon notification service. We need to discuss about CloudTrail. How to look for, configure CloudTrail. We need to go for Amazon Trusted Advisor. Then Amazon Inspector. I think so. We have discussed the Snowball. Apart from that, some new features have been added in our curriculum. Amazon EMR, Elastic MapReduce, how to configure a distributed cluster in Amazon. Okay, this is the EMR, Amazon EMR. So this is the thing that we are planning for today's session. Okay, Amazon EMR. So with this share, we are planning to cover CloudFront, Amazon Route S3, and Cloud Formation. We also added, apart from how to take snapshots, and how to make the snapshots automatic snapshots. Okay? So here CloudFront, Route S3, and this snapshot will be covered on coming Saturday. And here, the Cloud Formation, CloudTrail, and Amazon Trusted, all the opposite things can be covered on coming Sunday. Saturday and Sunday, we can able to cover almost all those things. Again, one small request. So, parallelly, I started my DevOps curriculum also. Almost three classes has been over. So, tomorrow we'll be having our class. Monday and Tuesday, we will be having our class. So it is Git. The time is 6:30 a.m. IST to 7:30 a.m. IST. So anyone interested, I will share you the link. Anyone interested, you can attend this. If you want DevOps along with the cloud, you can also attend this. Okay. So I will share you the previous two classes. Two classes has been over, the introduction to DevOps and associated tools. I will share you the link once today's class has been over. You can go through it. Only 2 hours of session has been so far completed. And we have started with the Git. And tomorrow I will make a recall for first 15 minutes what is Git and GitHub. And for some new participants. And I am going to follow after that. So that if you join on tomorrow, you can able to complete. So these are all some of the happenings associated with our classes. With this, let me start today's session of Amazon EMR, one of the most demanding features. Okay, Amazon EMR, which is nothing but configuring a distributed cluster using Amazon, one of the most demanding stuff one of today industry is looking for. Amazon Elastic MapReduce. EMR stands for Elastic MapReduce, which is nothing but today the buzzword of IT industry today is big data and cloud computing. Okay, big data and cloud computing. So here the concept that we are going to discuss with respect to Amazon EMR is big data. So which is big data is a generic term. What do you mean by big data? You people are aware of for storing and processing data. We have today traditional data, traditional way of storing and processing data today. Okay, the big data is one. How data has been stored? Earlier we have file systems. Earlier we have file systems for storing and processing data. So the languages like C, C++, Fortran, you have come across those sort of languages. Here for each and every activity, for creating a file, for inserting some data into the file, for deleting some information from the file, for dropping the file, you want to write not less than 15 to 20 lines of coding for each and every activity. So here only we used to store data in file system in ARIES in 1990s. Laterally, we make use of these databases. Databases for storing and processing data. We have a database management system. Here the database management examples of DBMS are Fox Pro, Fox Space. These are all some of the examples where we have a area by which you can able to store data and to process data in an easy manner. And laterally, so we have this RDBMS, Relational Database Management System, which comes with this client-server architecture. So you have data stored on a server. You have a computer called as a server, where you have a data, and user can able to access the data through a computer called as a client computers. Okay. So here, the data storage and data processing, storing of data, as well as the processing of data, both takes place in the server only. The client simply acts as an interface. Okay, the user, whatever command that you need to query, he can't able to directly access the database. So through that client, the query will be submitted and the query will be taken to the server. It got processed here, the result will be written back. Some of the famous examples are, if you want to go for a ticket reservation, a railway ticket reservation, okay, what you do? So you fill a form. Okay, you want to specify your name, you want to specify the train name, train number and train name, you want to specify the date of journey, you want to specify the class, first class or second class. After filling all those forms, you want to give the form to the ticket clerk who is sitting in the counter, booking clerk. The booking clerk will have a interface here. He will be submitting this, typing the information. Then the information will be processed at the server, where we have a centralized database. Here the details regarding, for example, train number 10, YH Express. So the date of the class, first class, the date of journey is 20/10/2017. The number of tickets, two tickets in sense. So all the information will be submitted in the client side. Okay, here the software we used here is called as a frontend. Okay, frontend is the client computer through which user will submit the request. This is your request. The request will be taken as a query and we have a database stored at one location. The server may be at Chennai, imagine. So all the client from Madurai, if you want to book a ticket from Tiruchi, if you want to book a ticket from Bangalore, so everything need to be connected with the server. Okay. So here the data will be stored in the server and data will be processed in the server itself. And once the query got processed here, whether the ticket is available on the day for first class will be written back to the front end. From the front end, it will be informed to the particular guy who is looking for booking a ticket. So here, this is the way by which you have a data stored and processed by means of a DB5 system, by means of a DBMS, and by means of RDBMS. So this concept of storing and processing data, okay? So in terms of this RDBMS is called as centralized database. So here it is a single server. You have data stored on a single server only. This is your server, under which you have your data. The location where you have your data has been termed as database. And you have multiple users. If they want to access the data, they want to interact with the computer called as a client computer. So here, you can't able to extend the data beyond this server. Imagine if the server has a capacity of 4 terabytes of storage, you can able to store up to 4 TB of data. If a user want to store 10 TB of data, what you need to do? So here we need to go for a concept called as a storage box. So people are already aware of storage box. You may have a sandbox, a storage area network, or you may have a network attached to storage. So it is a collection of bunch of disks here. You have data stored here. Your application may be running on your server. Whenever the application needs data, the data will be moved from the storage box into the server. And the data got processed here, the result once again, complete result will be stored back to the storage box. So this is the normal architecture. If you want to store and process data beyond its server's storage capacity, this work good if the amount of data that need to be transmitted is in terms of megabytes and in terms of gigabytes. Whereas here, that today's digital data, everything being it is computerized, everywhere we have computerized. So here we have huge volume of data. Those data are machine generated data. Those data are human generated data. So machine generated data such as data generated from sensors, data generated from RFIDs, okay? Sensors, RFIDs, data centers generated from some additional signals, telecommunication signals, etc., etc. These are all machine generated. Human generated data, and data generated in the social networking sites like Facebook, Twitter, okay? Some documents, videos, audios, etc., etc. These are all human generated data. So being everywhere, being it is computerized, starting from grocery shop up to the higher end applications, we have computerized, we have automation, we have everything, the entire industry is machinized. So you need to store, and you need to store, and you need to process data, not in terms of GB, but in terms of terabyte, petabyte, jettabyte, etc., etc. It goes on. In earlier days, you used to have data in terms of MBs and GBs. Now, because of everything has been automated, then everything has been mechanized. You need to store data, whatever may be the applications, whether it is a banking, whether it is insurance, healthcare, whether it is whatever may be, portfolio management, scientific exploration, weather forecasting, almost all sort of applications you want to need to store and process data in terms of terabytes, petabyte, etc. For example, if you consider Facebook, where they are generating around 500 terabytes of data per day. If you consider Twitter, Twitter is almost generating 200 terabytes of data per day. So all these things, if you have a server, nowadays you have a server which can able to store data in terms of up to 10 to 20 terabytes. If you want to store the data on Facebook, even one day data alone, it needs a capacity of 500 terabytes. So it is not at all possible to store and process today's digital data. So what we call it as a big data. A big data is a generic term. Okay, it is a generic term. So we refer the today's digital data as a big data. A big data is characterized by several characteristics that we will be discussing. Okay. So for storing and processing, what we call this big data, the architecture, the traditional architecture, centralized single server architecture, currently followed by this RDBMS, okay, which is not at all supported. Why so? Because you can't able to store data beyond this server capacity. The server capacity has been limited. If you want to store data, then you need to go for an architecture called a sandbox or an NASBox. But the drawback here is, if you want to move data in terms of terabyte, it took days to transfer data. For example, for transferring a film, a normal Tamil film, whose size is 3 GB from your laptop into your pen drive or something, how much of time that you need? It almost 3 to 5 minutes of duration that you need. Imagine if you want to transfer 1 TB. Okay, if you want to transfer 3 TB, it is almost 1,000 times that of this. So let me imagine if it took 5 minutes. So if you want to transfer 3 TB of data, it took 5,000 minutes. So 5,000 divided by 60 in cells. Okay, almost it took 80 days to complete the transfer. Okay, so 5,000 minute divided by 60, so 6. It took around 80 hours, not 80 days, 80 hours, almost 3 days to complete the transfer. Okay, am I making sense? So, storing your data and transfer the data in a single server architecture which employs this RDBMS. So, you have softwares like databases like Oracle, MySQL, SQL Server, etc., etc. This is coming under this RDBMS, which follows this client-server architecture, which is not at all possible. But almost all companies, almost all corporates, almost all government sectors, even individuals, they want to store and they want to process what we call as big data. They have all characteristics associated with big data. They need to store, they need to process those data, if they need an environment. But the current technology doesn't provide a support for the requirements. Okay, this is the drawback associated with the traditional architecture. So for that, we need a solution. The solution was provided by big corporates, big clients, okay, in form of data appliances. Okay, so the drawback of your RDBMS is you can't, being it is a single centralized architecture, you can't be able to store and process what you call this big data. Then you have a question in your mind. So what is big data? Generally, general definition for big data, any data. Any data means it may be a structured data, it may be a semi-structured data, or it may be unstructured data. Any data which is beyond the storage and processing capability of, which is beyond the storage and processing capability of a single centralized database server, which is nothing but the architecture currently followed by RDBMS, what we have discussed. A single centralized database architecture and possessing the following four key characteristics in terms of volume, in terms of velocity, in terms of variety, and in terms of veracity. Volume. The volume refers to the amount of data that you need to store. Okay, the amount of data that you need to store and process. Velocity refers to the rate at which the data has been generated, the speed or rate, the speed of generation of data. I will explain each and everything. The rate at which the data has been generated. The variety in terms of data has been concerned, as we discussed, there are three types of data. One is structure and semi-structure and unstructured. So here the data that is currently stored in RDBMS, okay, comes under the category. For example, if we take employee table, which contains employee number, employee name, and salary and job. Okay, so here the data has been organized in a well-defined manner. You have, so the employee number 1, employee name Ram, salary 9000, job DBA, so employee number 2, employee name Arun, salary 10000, job engineer. Okay, so this is the example of structured data. So you can able to access every element. For example, if you want to represent this Ram, how you can represent this Ram? We can able to represent this RAM by specifying the first row and the second column. Okay, R1 and first row 1 and column 2. So the, by the way, you have the data organized in terms of rows and column format. At any point of time, you can able to access any data. That is an example of structured data. Okay, so here the semi-structured data means, so examples of semi-structured data are your documents, your PDFs, your emails. Okay, these are all examples of semi-structured data. Example of unstructured data, your audio file, your video file, your images, okay, your server logs. These are all examples of unstructured data. If you consider today's digital data, almost 80% of data comes under semi-structured and unstructured. Only 20% of data alone comes under a structured data category. So if you are using R2, traditional RDBMS, you could provide a support of only 20% of today's digital data, and remaining 80% of data you couldn't able to provide a support if you go for this traditional RDBMS. Why so? Because of the opposite characteristics. The volume, the amount of data that we need to store and process, it starts from terabyte, minimum terabyte, petabyte, zettabyte, etc., etc. Okay. So, whereas your RDBMS support only up to terabytes. The rate at which the data has been generated. For example, let me take it. So, here, Amazon is currently having a Deepavali sale for 3 days. Okay, so here the Amazon's web server may be running. The number of users may populate the web server, try to access the web server. So here the web server will be connected to your database server. What are all the user requests is coming in will be stored in the database, or what the items that they are interested, whether they are purchased or not, all the information has been stored here. So here if you have a single centralized server, so you may imagine the server may have a capacity with the minimum number of microprocessors and minimum RAM memory and storage capacity. So it can able to handle if 1 lakh user, whatever may be the higher end server, it may support the 1 lakh user at a time and access. Imagine so throughout India, if 10 lakhs of user trying to access the server, if it is a single, this is the velocity, the rate at which the request is generated. If it is a single server architecture, it would be able to withstand this much of workload. When this much of load approaches the server doesn't know anything. It gets caught with panic. Okay, it gets caught with panic and server get crashed. Okay, this is the drawback associated with a normal centralized server. To overcome from this, what you need to do? You want to have your application running on multiple server. On front of it, you need to have a load balancer, and all the user requests will be redirected to each and every server accordingly. So that is the second drawback, the rate at which the data has been generated. Okay, so the third property is variety. Variety represents the type of data, structure data, semi-structure and structured data. The fourth property refers to veracity. How far your data is reliable, your reliability of your data. Okay, reliability of your data in sense, how far your data is reliable. So let me take this, first thing, let me make a differences about these two things so that okay, the difference between the traditional RDBMS and what we call as big data. The first difference is volume. Second difference is velocity. Third difference is variety. Fourth one, veracity. In terms of volume, it supports up to terabytes, gigabytes and up to terabytes. Here the big data starts with minimum terabyte, petabyte and petabyte and so on. That is the first difference. The rate at which the data has been generated, being it is a single server architecture, it supports gigabytes of data. If the incoming request size is gigabytes per hour, okay, it supports only this much of data request. Whereas here in big data, here it support, we need to support terabyte per hour, petabyte of data generation per hour. The data is approaching terabyte of data, petabyte of data to the server, it should provide a support for that. That is the difference between in terms of velocity. RDBMS, data generation speed is gigabyte, whereas if it is big data, terabyte and petabyte, example is Amazon sales, Deepavali sales. So here you want to, you are doing a rocket exploration. You launched a rocket. The rocket is going on into the space. You will gather all the needed information about the rocket. The amount of information is recorded across different locations. You have different antennas which sends the signals from the rocket, which is traveling in the space. And all those signals need to be stored and need to be processed. Imagine how much of data that you need to store and process. If you want to decide a gold price, each and every minute the gold price may vary. So if you want to find out the stock price may vary based upon several factors. So what the stock market will do, it will gather information from various sources, and based upon that, the stock may increase or decrease. So these are all some of the examples of velocity, the rate at which the data has been generated. Okay, the big data generates terabytes of data per hour, whereas RDBMS generates gigabytes of data per hour. In terms of this variety has been concerned, RDBMS support only structured data. The big data is one, it needs a support for structured data, unstructured data and semi-structured data. And veracity, how far your data is reliable. Okay, here being your data, you need to have very clear data. That is, you need to have the pre-processed data, and the data should not suffer from any anomalies. It should not have any missing value. It should not have any duplicate value. It should not have any missing value. It should not have duplicate value. It should have only relevant information. If yes, then only you can able to store and process data in RDBMS. Whereas, in case of big data, being you are crawling data from a machine made, you are crawling data from servers, you need to crawl data from sensors, you need to get the signals from antennas, okay? So everywhere, you need to get data from a real world entity. In this case, you can't able to ensure the data containing all the values. The data should not contain duplicate. So it may suffer from anomalies. So that is the key characteristics of big data. The tool that you are using for storing and processing big data, it should have a support to override all those anomalies. It has a missing value. The data will have missing value. It may have a duplicate value. It may have a irrelevant information. Everything need to be handled by that tool. The tool that we are using here is called as Hadoop. Okay, for storing and processing big data, we make use of a tool called as Hadoop. We'll be discussing this tool. Here our discussion is how to configure this Hadoop using Amazon EC2 instance, and how to make use of a distribution, a Hadoop distribution, EMR, which provided as a services in Amazon. These two are associated with our curriculum. Okay, so here, these are all the key characteristics associated. So now we need to go for the more important characteristics in terms of architecture. That is what that we are interested in. Apart from these key characteristics, you need to have the characteristics associated with the architecture. Okay, so this is RDBMS. This is big data. Generic term, you know what is big data. The tool here used is Hadoop. We are going to discuss with respect to this tool now. So in terms of the database architecture, it is a centralized database architecture. You have data stored on only a single server. Whereas here, this is a distributed database architecture. You have data stored across multiple servers. You have n number of servers. The server where we have data stored is called as data node. You may have data node 1, data node 2, up to n data nodes. Okay, DN stands for data nodes. Once the concept behind it, what is big data and what is its architecture has been discussed, then only you can able to realize what is the advantage in going for establishing this Hadoop big data cluster in cloud. So first 1.5 hour discussion will be only a theoretical concept behind big data today. After that, only installation perspective. This is the architecture. In terms of the infrastructure, infra architecture has been concerned, it is a client server architecture, which is a master slave architecture. So client server instance, you have only one server where you have your data and you have multiple clients. Whereas this architecture, you have some computer designated as master. Computer, you want to have a computer called name node. You need to configure a computer called secondary name node. You need to configure a computer called job tracker. These are all computers coming under master. And apart from that, you need to have computer called data nodes. You'll be having computers called task trackers. So these are all master computers. These are all slave computers. How a cluster will look like? A cluster will contain the following thing. You have only the architecture of this Hadoop. You have a name node. You need to configure a computer secondary name node. You need to configure a computer job tracker, under which you will be configuring multiple data nodes. Okay, you need to configure multiple data nodes. Data node 1, data node 2, up to n data nodes. This architecture, togetherly, we call it as a cluster, Hadoop cluster. A cluster of is a group of similar computers. So a group of computers, you call it as a cluster. So here you need to configure the above set computers. So in this case, what are all the things that we are discussing is associated with Hadoop. Now Hadoop, you have Hadoop 1.x, Hadoop 2.x. Currently we have 3.x, which is a beta version. We are discussing about this version 1.x and 2.x. In this Hadoop cluster, you need to configure this all the above set computers. Okay. So here, how many name nodes? How many secondary name nodes? How many data nodes? So here in this case, the number of name nodes, the number of secondary name nodes, and number of data tracker are one and only one. But the number of data nodes are n number of data nodes. You need to configure n number of data nodes. Then the number of data node configuring in the n number of data node depends upon two factors. What are all those two factors? Those two factors are you have in your cluster the following master name node. Imagine this as a computer. Secondary name node. You have job tracker and you need to have multiple data nodes. Data node 1, data node 2, up to n data nodes. Okay. This is the over. This is your Hadoop cluster. Here, the number of data nodes depends upon two factors. You can't able to design the data nodes. Whereas the master one and only one. Number of data nodes depends upon two factors. What are all those two factors which influence the number of data nodes? Factor one. Here, the amount of data that you need to store. The amount of data that we need to store. That is the first factor. The second factor is the hard disk capacity of your data nodes. Hard disk capacity of your data nodes. Imagine each data node is having a 2 terabyte of hard disk capacity. So you have a 10 TB of data. Imagine you have a 10 TB of data that need to be stored is 10 TB. But each data node's capacity is 2 TB. The hard disk capacity of your data node is 2 TB. For storing 10 TB, how many data nodes that you need to have? The number of data nodes that you need to have is 5 data nodes. You need to have 5 data nodes. Okay, here you have 5 data nodes. And how this 10 TB of data has been stored? This 10 TB of data, this 10 TB of data is split into 2 TB, 2 TB each, and this 2 TB has been stored across all these data nodes. This is, by the way, here the 10 TB has been split and it is distributed. It is split into 2 TB and it is distributed across these 5 data nodes. This is called as a distributed database. This is called distributed database. Now, if it is a centralized database, as that of your RDBMS, your server should have a capacity for storing 10 TB. If not, if it contains only 4 TB, then you need to go for a solution called storage box as discussed. And also we discussed about the drawback. So here, if the data size increases to 10 TB, if the data size increases to another 10 TB, now, you have 20 TB of data. You no need to worry about. What you can do? You can add additional 5 data nodes. Now, you have initially data node 1 to data node 5. Now, you have additional 5. You can go and add the number of data nodes in the cluster without worrying about that. Okay? This property now, this 20 TB has been split into 2 TB and it will be stored across all the 10 data nodes. You no need to worry about if it is 200 TB of data, no issue. Okay, you can add 100 data nodes. You can go and add the data nodes as the data size increases. This feature of adding an additional computer to accommodate the needed storage has been termed as scaling. So here the scaling can be categorized into two types. One is the vertical scaling. Another one is the horizontal scaling. So vertical scaling in sense, you have a system, you have one hard disk, we will be adding additional hard disk. We will be adding additional, the hard disk will be added onto the same server. If it is horizontal scaling, you won't add the hard disk. You will be adding your servers itself. What is the drawback associated with the vertical scaling? So the vertical scaling is limited with respect to the number of hard disk slot. How many slots that is available in the server? That much of hard disk alone can be added here. Whereas in terms of horizontal scaling, you no need to worry about. As your data increases, you can go on and increase the size of the cluster by adding new computers. There is no limitation. You can go and add your computers, and if you want, you can extend your network according to your requirement. So the concept of the distributed database is applying not the vertical scaling, it applies the concept of horizontal scaling. So in this case, it is the responsibility of the administrator. You have in terms of big data admin, the responsibility of the administrator is to configure this Hadoop cluster. Nowadays, the companies almost, if you want, imagine if you want to store 200 TB of data, you need to have 100 data nodes. You need to have a network engineer. You need to have a storage engineer. You need to have a big data engineer. So here you need to invest for the infrastructure. The initial cost of investing for 100 nodes, 100 computers, and to establish a network of TDS. So to overcome from that, almost all companies, nearly out of 100 companies, all startup companies, entry-level companies, startup companies, so mid-level companies, okay, they are those companies which have a constraint in the budget. They are going up with the cloud-based infrastructure for this big data. They no need to worry about. They know if the data increases, suddenly they can able to add additional data nodes within a fraction of a second by using the concept of auto scaling. If it is a physical cluster, if you have set up a physical cluster, initially the cluster is 5. If you want to store additional 20 terabyte of data, what you need to do? You want to procure additional 5 machines, and you need to configure, attach, and you need to attach with the existing server. If you want to add additional, you have now additional 20 terabyte of data for storing 40 TB. You want to purchase additional 10 computers, and you need to attach with the cluster. So, which is a time-consuming process. If the infra is taken from cloud like AWS, so but if you have configured this auto-scaling here, according to your workload, you can go and add your servers within a fraction of a second. You no need to worry about the infrastructure. You no need to worry about the initial cost of investment. You no need to worry about the monitoring and maintenance overhead. Everything will be taken care of by the cloud. People are aware of. So because of the opposite reasons, for reducing the infrastructure, by reducing the maintenance and monitoring overhead, almost all companies, while they are, when they have a Hadoop cluster for deployment, they are making use of the solution based upon this cloud-based infrastructure. And it is the responsibility of the cloud engineer to establish the cluster according to the requirement. So because of the reason, almost all companies, now they are recruiting cloud engineers if they have to manage and to run a big data Hadoop cluster. So our curriculum, also our certificate of Amazon Solution Architect, now included this new feature, Elastic MapReduce, as a part of Amazon Solution Architect Associate Examination. Okay, so now you know what is big data and how big data differs from traditional data, and in terms of architecture, what is the differences between the database, the centralized and distributed database, and what are all the computers that need to form a part of this Hadoop framework. So our intention, we need to configure this Hadoop cluster. Okay, how to configure, that we are going to discuss. Before going into that, if you have any problem, if you have any doubt that need to be clarified, please let me know. Kabilan, Muthu, Suresh, Shiva, Suresh. Am I making sense with what I am presenting?
I'm good.
Is it clear?
Yes.
Yes.
Yes, I'm good.
Now? Thank you. So as a admin, as a cloud admin, what we need to do? We need to as a cloud engineer, we need to establish this cluster. Okay, so we can have this cluster established under two ways, by using infrastructure as a service and second by using Hadoop as a service. So please make a note. You can establish this cluster using infrastructure as a service and second by using Hadoop as a service. What is infrastructure as a service? So you take a EC2, you take a Linux instance, okay? You take a Linux instance and you configure on top of it the needed entity. So to configure a Hadoop cluster, whether it is, you know, name node or secondary name node or job tracker or n number of data nodes, you need to configure several things. Imagine, so what are all the things that you need to configure? First, you want to install the operating system, any Linux operating system. Here let me install Ubuntu. In terms of OS, any Linux you need to install. Now you need to install Java JDK 1.7 and above. You need to configure SSK server. And SSK client need to be configured. You need to generate key generation, SSK IP key generation. You need to go for SSK key generation and you need to download and you need to install this Hadoop framework, which is an open source framework. And step 6, you need to populate around 7 configuration files that we will be discussing. You need to populate around 7 configuration files. After that, you need to format the cloud. You need to format the system. After that, you need to start the service. These are all the sequence of activity that you need to do. Okay? So here, whether whatever may be the computer, name node or master node or slave nodes, you need to configure all the opposite things. You can do, if you go for this infrastructure as a service, what you can do? You need to get an EC2 instance, step by step that you need to configure all those things. If you want to establish a Hadoop cluster, with 100 data nodes, how you can achieve this? You need to create 100 EC2 instances. And you need to configure 100 EC2 instances with the opposite things. Imagine it took minimum 20 to 25 minutes to configure all the opposite activity that I have listed. Minimum 20-25 minutes. If you want to configure for 100 data nodes, how it is possible? How much of time that you need? What is the solution that you can make use of it? Can anyone let me know? What is the... Okay. Sahistri, I have shared you a document which containing 4 files. Okay. So please, I also listed you which file that you need to give focus. Probably file 3 and file 4, I think so. If time permits, and it is referred to going with file 2. Yes?
Yes, sir. But when I'm trying to access the link, it's showing some error, 404 error.
404 error. So, okay, I will do one thing. I think so. I can download a copy with me. I will check it and I will share to you. Most.
Yeah. Yes, sir. Thank you.
Okay, yeah, yes. So, in terms of this Hadoop cluster has been concerned, in terms of this Hadoop cluster has been concerned, there are 2 ways that you can configure your cluster. One is single node cluster, and second, Hadoop multi node cluster. Single node cluster in a single computer You will be configuring name node. You will be configuring secondary name node. You will be configuring job bracket, data node, task bracket, everything. You configure Java. You configure SSH. Okay, SSH server, everything, etc., etc. You will be configuring, and all the services will be running on a single computer. It is meant for learning purpose. Okay, to understand what you need to configure in a Hadoop cluster, that you go for this single node. Whereas in case of this multi-node, you will be having a separate computer. Okay, you will be having a computer called name node. You will be having a secondary name node. You will be having job tracker. You will be having multiple data nodes. Data node 1 up to data node n. Okay, this is your production setup. So here our curriculum deals with how to configure a single node cluster. Okay, using Amazon infrastructure as a service, and we are going to deal with a multi-node cluster using Hadoop as a service. Okay, so this is the thing that we are going to do. Now you can take a break for 5 minutes and be back. And now the time is 7:12. To be back within 7:20, we can continue with the practical. Okay, with this introduction about theory, I think so it is sufficient enough so that we can go up with the practical. Now, what I am going to do is, so I am going to now do the following. I am going to create an instance. I am going to create a Linux instance. So that is Ubuntu 16.04, and I am going to do all the aforesaid activity that is listed. Okay, so after that a Hadoop cluster will be configured. It took another 40 minutes to complete this. You please go for a break and be back within 10 minutes. Thanks. Yes, what we have discussed in the first half of the session, here this is the thing that we have discussed, how to configure a cluster. We have discussed about the cluster concept, what is Hadoop, everything. Now the agenda for second part of the session is how to configure a Hadoop cluster. And after that, by using this, we are going to configure a single node cluster. And by using the single node cluster, we are going to create a private AMI. From the private AMI, we can able to install the needed number of data nodes. We can go for with the multi-node cluster. So here in terms of Hadoop cluster has been concerned. These are all the computers that we need to launch. Name node, secondary name node, job tracker, data nodes. Those first part of the computer comes under master, and the bottom part comes under the slave nodes. Here you may have one doubt, as I told, whether you need to have a separate set of software, operating system that need to install for master and that need to install for slave. The answer is no. Whether it is a master or slave, doesn't matter. What are all the things? Please mute participant. So what are all the things that you need to install for the master need to be repeated for the slave. But the difference here is, if it is a master or if it is a slave, that thing need to be defined under 7 configuration files. We will be discussing about those configuration files. There are core-site, mapred-site, htdfs-site, masters, slaves, pass RC file, that thing that we will be discussing. Also, in terms of this Hadoop cluster has been concerned, there are a physical cluster. We can configure a physical cluster. We can go for a cluster based upon the virtualization concept. We can install VMware and we can configure virtual machines. But in today's environment, several companies that they are going up configuring the cluster by using a cloud infrastructure. Also, because of the limitation associated with the physical cluster, you need to invest huge for initial cost of establishment. And if you want to make a scale, it is very difficult in scaling. So these are all some of the reasons that have been discussed. To overcome from that, almost all companies that they are aiming at a cloud infrastructure for configuring the cluster. In cloud, we have infrastructure as a service and Hadoop as a service. Okay. Apart from that, we have several distributions like Cloudera distribution, Hortonworks distribution, MapR distribution, EMR distribution. The distribution that is associated with Amazon Cloud is EMR distribution. Okay. each and every cloud will have their own distribution. Microsoft Azure will have its own distribution. So Google Cloud may have their own distribution. Okay, the distribution associated with Amazon is EMR. So these are all some of the introductions before going up into how to do, what are all the configuration files that you need to go for, and what are all the ways by which you can create and you can configure, that we are going to discuss now. Okay.
For example, so this is the IP address as in 10.1. This is the IP address on 192.100.10.5, if we assume. So in core-site.xml file, so if we specify 192.100.10.5, the IP address, then this computer will act as a name node. That's all. Okay, if you specify 192.100.10.1, then this computer may act as a name. So according to this specification, the IP address of that machine that we have mentioned in the corresponding configuration file, it will act as a name node or it will act as a secondary name node. Okay, so just make a note of this. Here, if you want to configure this number of machines, so what you need to do? So here, that is the option. First, you want to create one machine. That is, create a single machine and you install each and everything what we have defined today. So after the creating a single machine, Ubuntu virtual machine, installing Java, installing OpenSSH server, generating keys and installing Hadoop. Okay, what you need to do, you want to create a private AMI. From the private AMI, you can create this virtual machine, Ubuntu 1 to Ubuntu 12. And open the corresponding configuration files and you make it the computer as a secondary name node or job tracker or data node as you like. Okay, this is the way by which a real time cluster will implement. Okay, so in this you want to make use of a private AMI. Am I making sense? Now we are going to configure a single machine. Okay, on top of it we are going to install the machine. Will we connect which? AWS, AWS Management Console, we create the EC2 instance and install all on top of. So you can use any Linux driver. I am going to make use of Ubuntu since we are compatible with that. Ubuntu will be on branch. Launch. Launch. So if we make it as name node. Selection procedure. first thing on the name to do. So you want to first perform an update, sudo apt concern get update. Yes. Next, you want to install Java. Let me check whether we have Java. It won't present by default. So let me install Java. Sudo apt and get install open JDK -8-JDK. So here, since we are already installed the Ubuntu 8, JDK 7 won't support. That's why you need to install JDK 8. Next, we need to install OpenSSH server. So it is used to establish OpenSSH server. Okay. Already the news person. Already we are having OpenSSH server. Next, you need to generate key. Okay, here what you are doing is you want to generate two keys. So you should not use the sudo command. Also, because if you use the sudo, it will generate the key under the root user's .ssh. So here, if you use sudo ssh-kz, here it will generate a key under root, under .ssh, this key, two keys, id underscore rsa dot pub will be created. But you, being you are logged in as a Ubuntu user, what you need to do, you want to create the key without using sudo ssh. Then only under the Ubuntu user's home location, under home, Ubuntu, under .ssh, the keys will be generated. Please find them out. So, forgettingly, we may type a sudo, it may result in error. So, you should not use a sudo command for this purpose. This is -kz. To look into this location where it is asking for, under home Ubuntu, .ssh and idrsa key will be generated, simply enter. Now, passphrase, it will ask for whether you need to have the additional level of security. So, no, default is no. So, it is similar to you are having a bank locker. The locker is already locked and you will allow have a privilege key. Apart from that, some person may have a lock on top of it. Similarly, okay, without having a trust with bank, they may have a lock on top of the locker. So like that, if you want to have some additional keys, here that additional key can be added through this passphrase. So I am not interested in adding additional key, therefore simply press enter. Okay? Yes. Now this is the fingerprint. Okay? They use this algorithm, SHA algorithm, for our authenticate. Okay. platform, Ubuntu, .ssh, id, underscore, rsi.pub. Slash home under the same location Ubuntu dot ssh. You want to create author paste underscore keys. Okay, file by name authorized underscore keys is present under the corresponding user's ssh folder, and if the key content is fingerprint, then that user will be considered as an authenticated user. So without asking password, the user will be given permission. That is the reason only we are creating this key. Okay, so here's all you need to do. If you didn't create this key, here it will result that in you are going to configure multiple nodes in your cluster, name node, secondary name node, dot tracker, and n number of data nodes. Imagine you have 100 data nodes. So what you need to do, you want to create a key, id underscore rsa.pub key in your master node, and you want to copy the key into another file called as authorized underscore keys file, and this authorized underscore keys file need to be placed in all the computer. Now all data nodes and all secondary name nodes. Therefore, during the start of the computer, each and every computer, it asks for username and password. If the computer first is while doing this start, what it will look in? It will look into the corresponding SSH folder. If the SSH folder contains this authorized underscore keys, and it will look for a fingerprint, if it found the fingerprint, then it will consider that the user as a legitimate user. Okay, and without asking password, username, password, all the services will be started on the server. Yes, if you doesn't generate this ID underscore RSA.pub key, and if you don't copy this authorized underscore key, each and every time while starting the server and while stopping the server, you need to enter username and password. Imagine if you have a cluster of 100 servers, each and every time you need to type username and password 100 times. That is the reason why we are creating this authorized underscore key files. Make a note, this question was asked in the interview. If your authorized underscore key files key print is corrupted, what will be the impact in your cluster? In this manner, this question was put across. Okay, now we have created the key and we want to check. Okay, after it is working fine, SSH space local port. Without asking password, yes, it should enter. Yes, it is working fine. So without asking password, if it enters, it is working fine. Next, now we are under present working directory home Ubuntu. We need to download this Hadoop. The command to download Hadoop is wget. You want to paste the URL. Okay, so go here. Hadoop download. Here you want to go to this Apache Hadoop releases. Click on Apache Hadoop releases. Download from the mirror set. These are all the current versions. You are going to download 1.2. Download from the mirror set. Click on any mirror. Go to Hadoop. Okay, so this is the file that you need to have. 61 MB. Hadoop.tar.js file. Please make a note. This file is a binary file. So it is an open source. You can download this binary file and you can do the needed modification on top of the file, so that you can release your own distribution. Okay, if you want to do any customized on this Hadoop framework, you need to download this bin file and you can do the needed modifications. And according the modifications done, the Hadoop cluster will function accordingly. Okay, so here we are responsible only for admin purpose. Simply, the file that you need to choose is 61 MB Hadoop iPhone 1.2.1.json. Okay, right click, copy link address, come to the location, simply right click, the link address will be pasted, enter, it will download. Yes, it was downloaded. Now you can find we have a Hadoop 1.2.1. So on top, tar iPhone SVF, extract verbose file, on top. Yes. Now, Hadoop is ready. Okay. Hadoop 1.2.2. Okay, move to this location. CD. Hadoop 1.2.1. You can find this conf folder and bin folder. Conf folder containing all the configuration files. The bin folder containing all the starting and stopping scripts. Okay. So, now you move to the conf folder, conf. Another conf folder, you can find all the files. HDFS-4-site, MapRed-site. Okay, now let me populate this file. So, let me enter. I will show you a document. So, using which you can do this activity. Okay, we perform the update, we install OpenSSH, we have generated key, we have created this authorized underscore keys, okay, we have installed Java, we have extracted Hadoop. So first what you need to do, Hadoop-core-site.xml, okay, so here you want to copy from the property to this property. Here this contains two things, one is the file system that default name HDFS:localhost. Okay, being it is a single node server, we are specifying this as a local host. If you are going to configure a multi-node cluster, then this local host needs to be replaced with the IP address of the computer that you are going to make it as name node. Please make a note. And this is the port number. This port number is fixed. Okay, 54310. Hadoop will listen for a name node under the following port. Okay, the port number is fixed. Instead of local port, it needs to be replaced with the IP address of the computer. Then this property, the second property, Hadoop temporary, you need to create a temporary directory for storing name node related information. Okay, so this is the any at any location you can create, and any name you can create. So I create. I am going to create using a name by temp data. It is your choice. You can simply create a temp or you can create a data anything at any location. So here I am creating under the home class Ubuntu. The name of the directory is temp data. Okay. So let me simply copy and paste the file. Go to the location. Copy from property to property. For instance, site contains the IP address of your name node. Simply copy, move to this, and open your VA editor. Sudo VA, the file is 4-site.xml. Okay, so move to the location. Between this configuration, you have already open and close configuration tab. Move to the location, insert, and simply right click. The content that you have copied will be pasted here. Escape colon W. I think so. You have idea how to work with the Okay, it will feel difficult. You can't hear a VNC at the profit, the graphical user interface will be found and you can do the nearest. Next, what you are going to do, after for hyphen-save.xml, the next thing that we are going to do is maprad-save.xml. Here in maprad-site.xml, you want to specify the job tracker's IP address. So being it is a single node, we make it as a local host. And this is the port number. If it is a multi-node, need to be replaced with the computer, which we are going to configure as a job tracker. Copy from property to property. Right click. Copy. Go to the location. Sudo vi. maprad-site.xml. Come to draw. Simply press I insert key. Then now you will have an insert tag in the top or in the bottom. Simply right click. Okay. Escape colon W. Now you have this maprad-site.xml configured. Next file that you need to configure is HTTPS-site.xml. In HTTPS-site.xml, you want to specify the replication property, number of copies, number of block copies. Here, the file will be divided into blocks here. Each and every file will be divided into blocks, and the blocks will be stored across these data nodes here. Okay? So, since you are having multiple data nodes, imagine, a data node is made up of either a commodity hardware, as I already told. You have data node 1. Imagine you have data node 2 and 3 data node 3. So you are having a file own.txt, whose size is assumed to be 192 MB. If we assume this file contains 30,000 transaction records. This file contains 30,000 records. So the size is 192 MB. Here, how Hadoop will store this file? It will be divided into a block size of 64 MB. This is the default block size. Please make a note. The file will be split into block, and the default size of the block is 64 MB. Okay, so that's such a huge block size. Your OS block will be either 4 KB or it will be 8 KB. For example, database like Oracle, the default block size for this Oracle is 8 KB. Whereas for your Linux and Windows file system, probably it may be for OS, it may be block size is 4 KB. But here, since you are going to put this data in terms of terabyte and petabyte, if you have a block of size in terms of KB, there will be lakhs and lakhs of blocks need to be maintained. Because of this reason, it is architecture in such a manner that instead of having a KB, they made it as a MB. Please make a note. This is also one time this question was asked in interview. So the default block size is 64 MB. Therefore, this file of 192 MB divided into three blocks. Block B1, B2, and B3. Here, this block will be stored here in this manner. It will be distributed across these data nodes. Imagine you have only one copy. And the data node, as I already told, is made up of commodity hardware. What is commodity? Low cost hardware. You can make use of i3, i5, i5-7 like machine. So if you make use of this sort of machine, there is a huge probability that that machine is subjected to frequent failures. Okay? You can't able to predict the failure of the hardware, of this commodity hardware. So what happened here in this case? Imagine if a machine fails, if your data node TN2 fails. What happens in this case? The data associated with the block B3 will be lost. Okay? Then you will be left out with only block B1 and block B2. So to overcome from this sort of data loss, what Hadoop recommends is minimum. Hadoop recommends to go for 3 replica for each and every block. So the block B1 need to be copied across 3 locations in this manner. Similarly, block B2 also need to be copied across 3 locations. Okay? So what happens if this data node DN2 down? Then we have a copy of on the block in data node 1 and data node 2. So the activity, the business can be continued without any disruption. Okay, this is the way by which you need to specify. Since we are going to create all the nodes on a single computer, say name node, job tracker and data node and task tracker. So what you need to do, you can't have minimum 3 Rashika. Also because you need to have 3 data nodes, you cannot have all the 3 same blocks, 3 copy on the same data node. The condition is that you can't have more than one copy of the same block in one data node. At least one data node should contain only one block copy. Okay? So therefore it is mandatory that your block need to be stored across multiple data nodes. So since you are going to configure a single node cluster, so if you don't do anything under this HDFS-site.xml, under this HDFS-site.xml, what you are going to do, you are going to overwrite the default replica of 3 into 1. Also because since we are having only one node, so if you don't specify this default replica, will be taken into consideration and it will look for 3 data nodes and it will result in an error. So data node not found. Okay, that is the reason why we need to do this change in the HDFS-site. So this HDFS-site.xml contains the number of DFS.replication. Distributed file system replication is 1. That means we are expecting to store only one block copy instead of 3. So if you want to store 5 block copy, here you want to specify 5. So if you don't specify anything, it will take the default. The default is 3 replica. Please make a note. Okay, so copy. And move to the location. Sudo vi hdfs-site.xml. Move to the location. Simply insert. Right click. It will copy. Escape. Colon. WP. Now we have masters. Sudo master will contain already local folks. Okay, by default it will contain the local host file, escape, colon, q exclamatory. Similarly, so you have slaves also contains the same local host. But if you use a multi-node, you need to replace with the corresponding IP address. Okay, now we have another file, we have a configured Hadoop-environment.sh. Sudo vi Hadoop -environment.sh, all environmental variables need to be set here. So you can find a Java home here. So you can insert Java home in this location. Okay, go to Java by default, it will be installed in the following location. Okay, this is the default location of in Java. User lib JVM, okay, Java -. 8 AMD64. So big it is a 64 build. This is the Hadoop user lib JVM Java-8 OpenJDK AMD64. Simply copy and paste it. Right click, paste. This is the default location if you install OpenJDK. Okay, W3. Next, what you need to do, so you have configured all the 6 files, core icon site, mapped, HDFS, master slave. Next, you want to configure 3 things, Hadoop home, Java home, and your class for in your .bashrc file. Okay, your bashrc file will be under /home/Hadoop. Therefore, simply move back. cd.dot. Now you are under present working directory home Hadoop. If you type ls, it doesn't show anything. ls-al will show you all the hidden files. Okay. So since bashrc file is a hidden file, a file starting with dot will be listed by using a -a command. It is adrib. Okay, you know the concept of hidden files. All system files will be as a hidden files. To open the file and type the following thing. So va sudo va dot dash r. So you move to the last line of your file. In bash rc, you want to move to the last line. And simply press alt o to make a new line. Click make an alt key plus 4. You want to type alt key plus 4. It will take you to the last line. A new line will be inserted. Here you need to specify that in Java's form path. You need to specify export hello underscore home equal to the location as you are configured under home under Ubuntu hello -1.2.1. Okay, hello -1.2.1. Next, export path. You want to specify class path. Path equal to already existing path, path, dollar path, colon, dollar, java, underscore, home, slash, bin need to be small letter, colon, dollar, hadoop, underscore, home, slash, bin need to be small letter. These are all the three things that you need to set, java, home, hadoop, home, home Ubuntu, hadoop -1.2.1, dollar path colon, dollar java home bin, hadoop home bin. Okay, escape, colon, w. Small letter w. After that, you simply take source dot bash rc. Why you are sourcing itself? To make this notify the change to the kernel. Else you need to restart. Okay, the bash rc file will be read each and every time. Like Linux kernel will boot. So since we have did the change after booting, in order to make the change updated, either you need to restart the machine or simply type source not bash rc instance. The kernel will reread the bash rc file and it will make notified the following changes are we need here. Okay, so start by starting. Now everything is proper. You need to format. So the command to format is move to the Hadoop installed location. Here, before that, what you need to do? You want to create a folder. Okay, make directory temp data. So this is the thing that we have specified in our file. Okay, for core-data.xml, we have specified. Under home Ubuntu, a folder by name temp data, that folder need to be created. If not else, it may result in a failure of starting up name. The temp data is created. Now let me format. Hadoop -1.2.1, here the command is bin slash Hadoop space name node space -format. You want to get this message successfully formatted. If you get any other message apart from that, it shows it is not formatted properly. Now, we start the service. The command to start the service is start now. Before starting the service, let me check JPS. Nothing is running. Okay, JPS stands for Java Process Script. Start -all.sh. It is the script which will start all the services one by one. Okay. Now you can find name node, data node, and the secondary name node, job tracker, task tracker has been started. If you repeat the same command, JPS, now you can find everything has been started. Okay, name node, all are running as a process. These are all the corresponding process items. Okay, so this is the way by which you can configure a Hadoop cluster. So to stop the service, simply stop -all.sh. It will stop the corresponding services. stop one by one. So if you type GPS, it won't show anything. Okay. So to so we need 0, it will come out of this particular machine. Okay. So this is the way by which you need to create a Hadoop cluster.
Okay, is it clear for you? So what are all the things that we have discussed? We'll let you know the configuration of what we have discussed in the first half of our session, configuring a single node cluster. So you need to repeat this process. What you need to do? You want to create an AMI, that's you want to create a private AMI, and you need to register with Amazon Cloud. And from the AMI, you can create the needed instances according to your multi-node cluster. So if you are looking for a 10-node data cluster, you need to create up to 10 instances. Where you need to specify? So at the time of creating an instance from that registered private AMI, you need to specify under a tag called number of instances. Okay. So all the instances that you have created from the private AMI, by default, it will be configured all the upper-set process what we have listed out in the past 45 minutes. Okay. So this this particular content added in your profile will be a much more value added thing. Okay. In terms of interview perspective, what are all the things that I have listed alone will be asked to you. I will share certain interview questions with respect to this EMR. It comes around 20-25 interview questions. Apart from this cloud, totally there are around 100 plus interview questions, whatever may be the company. If you opt for a level of not less than 5 years, you can able to answer those questions. I am having a collection of interview questions appeared by the participating students in Wipro, TCS, Infosys, etc. So that you can make an opportunity of to which extent that you are aware of and what is the level of training that we have so far. Okay. So, do you have any doubt? Suresh, Sai Sri, Kabidan, Siva, Muthu?
I am good, sir.
Yeah, yes. Okay, Sri, I will share you the updated solution on data associate professional terms within today night. When you are appearing for interview, so when you are appearing for examination, what is the scheduled date? I think so. It is
yeah, scheduled on 18th, the slots is available only Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday. So, okay. Any date from
okay, just I will share to you. You please look into that. It will be around 300 plus questions only. So it may be plus or minus 10%. You may come across some questions which is not at all present there. So that is the maximum possibility. Okay. So do you have any terms with you?
Sorry, sir, I didn't get you.
Whether you have any other terms apart from that, what I am going to share for you?
No.
Okay, no issue. You just look into that. You will resume now. Time is 8. I will try to upload this and I can chat to you before 10:30. You please go through that. In case any doubt, feel free to call me. Thanks a lot. Have a
thank you,
good day. So, happy Deepavali. We will be meeting on coming Saturday. So, I think so. You people also have a joyful day there in US. Suresh?
Yeah, Ramesh.
Yes. Have a happy Diwali. Muthu sir, Suresh, Siva.
Yeah. Thank you.
Yes, thanks a lot. I will share you the update.
Thank you, Ramesh.
Today. So we can meet again on coming Saturday. Bye. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.